Thank you. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face covering should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The final item of business is a members' business debate on motion 1604 in the name of Katy Clark on domestic abuse charges. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons now. And I call on Katy Clark to open the debate.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And it's a very welcome opportunity today to discuss the significant problem of domestic abuse in Scotland and how the legal system deals with these kinds of situations. And I would like to put on record my thanks to the members who have signed this members' motion, which has enabled this debate to take place today. I will focus on the issues involved in domestic violence charges, rather than rape and sexual offence cases, which I have spoken about previously, and which the government is, of course, considering in relation to the recommendations from Lady Dorian's report on rape and sexual offence cases. There were over 33,000 charges with a domestic abuse identifier reported to the Crown Office and the Procurator Fiscal's Office during the year 2020 to 2021. That was a 9% increase on the year before. And about one in four of those cases were classed as common assault. Many women and girls, of course, do not go to the police. And violence against women and girls is endemic in our society. This, of course, relates to wider issues and the power relationship between men and women. However, the justice system has a track record of failing to deal with many of the domestic abuse cases which are taken to the authorities in an acceptable way. Many women and girls who have suffered domestic abuse have described their experiences of the justice system as being re-traumatising. It is clear that improving the experiences of women and girls requires significant changes to the justice system. Since the creation of the Scottish Parliament, MSPs in all political parties have attempted to highlight the issue of domestic violence and make legislative changes to improve how cases are handled. Some of the examples of how things have changed is that now we have separate facilities for domestic abuse cases in some parts of the country so that the complainer does not have to go through the unpleasant experience of attending court. And also in some cases, evidence is taken by commission, which means that the victim doesn't have to go to court. And that obviously is often particularly important when it's young children who are giving evidence. My motion calls on the Scottish Government to analyse and evaluate the outcomes of specialist domestic abuse courts, which have operated in some parts of the country, and in particular Glasgow and Edinburgh, and to lay out a strategy for rolling out specialist abuse courts across the country. Potentially, specialist domestic abuse courts offer an opportunity to massively change the way that domestic abuse charges are dealt with trauma-informed approaches, the ability to have specialist premises, a focus on consistent sentencing, and indeed specialist prosecutors dealing with cases. On the 30th of November, we debated a government motion on gender-based violence, and Scottish Labour put down an amendment to that motion calling on the government to evaluate specialist domestic abuse courts with a view to rolling them out across the country. The SNP voted against that amendment on that occasion, but I very much hope that this is something that the government is willing to look at, and that vote was on a technicality, and that the government will accept that they have the power to introduce these courts throughout the country. In May last year, the Scottish Courts and Tribunals Service set up a pilot project for virtual summary criminal trials to be conducted in Aberdeen and Inverness Sheriff Courts. After an interim report, a Virtual Trials National Project Board was established, where all interested groups were represented. And in Aberdeen, the pilot continued for domestic abuse cases only, using a remote facility for witnesses under the supervision of Victim Support Scotland. Last week, the Board reported to the Lord Justice General and the Cabinet Secretary. It recommended that every sheriffdom in Scotland should have a dedicated specialist online court for domestic abuse cases. Their report says that a virtual dedicated specialist summary court would offer advantages by increasing protection, reducing trauma for complainers, making it easier for witnesses to give evidence, offering some efficiencies in reducing travel, in maintaining efficiency and consistency, and also introducing trauma-informed practices. It also said that virtual courts had the impact of mitigating delays caused by the pandemic, as about a quarter of all outstanding summary court cases are domestic abuse cases. Victims groups have been campaigning for these courts and have been positive about this pilot. The review also concluded that representation from defence agents was that the accused had received a fair trial. And of course, that's one of the concerns in particular about virtual courts. It is clear that the way the police, the courts and the wider legal system have operated in the past has not delivered justice to women. I hope that the Scottish Government will be willing to act to introduce specialist domestic violence courts. There is a debate to be had as to what extent these courts should be virtual, and I have no doubt that the Criminal Justice Committee will look at that aspect over the coming weeks as it considers the COVID recovery legislation. However, violence and the fear of violence touches all women's lives. I look forward to the contributions from members, and I hope that we will get action from the government on this issue.
Thank you, Ms Clark. I now call Paul McLennan to be followed by Russell Finlay.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And can I thank Katy Clark for bringing this important topic to the Chamber? As we've already heard today, domestic abuse charges in Scotland have now increased for the fifth consecutive year. And of course, Katy mentioned there around about 33,000 cases. In my constituency, that was 111 incidents that were reported last year. That's one reported incident every 3 days. That alone is a staggering figure. However, we know these figures do not reveal the true extent of domestic abuse in our communities. And I recently visited East Lothian Women and Mid Lothian Women's Aid. And one of the things they talked about barriers about actually going and talking about this was getting, I suppose, the report they've seen as justice for the acts that have been carried out in them. And I think, you know, for a myriad of reasons, they don't often report their abusers. I'll let the Minister address the key point that Katy mentioned around about the domestic abuse courts and her summing up. The scale of violence within our society has reached pandemic proportions. And at that violence, at its very core, it's gender-based. It's gender-based. Whatever that be, men's violence against women and girls or men's violence against men and boys. Domestic abuse perpetrated by men against women is rooted in women's unequal status in society, and that's at the core of the problem. And men need to be seeing that more and more and more. And it's part of the wider social problem of male violence against women and girls. Research from the University of Bristol reveals that sexism and misogyny set the scene for male abusive partners' coercive and controlling behaviours. Dr. Jackson Katz's research delves even further into the root causes of male violence against women. This work focuses predominantly on attitudes and beliefs of manhood that society actively teaches. He encourages us not to think of men who are violent towards women as pathological monsters and not as individual perpetrators, but instead we need to think about our society. Our society that is producing these abusive, violent men on a regular basis, generation after generation, across class, race and ethnicity. Rape culture, sports culture, porn culture, peer culture and media culture, all these influences teach men certain lessons about manhood and social norms that are produced and reproduced at every level. Earlier today, I met with Graham Golden, formerly of the Violence Reduction Unit. There was an eye-opening meeting, and certainly for myself. He said to me in our meeting that it's the same system that produces men who abuse harm and violent towards women that produces men who abuse and harm and are violent towards men also. That is not said in the spirit of minimising women's experience of male violence, but rather to illustrate that men and women have a common enemy, and that is male violence. This recognition is important in helping us frame male violence against women in a way that brings men into the conversation. And again, we need to do that more and more and more. And we've got a leadership role in our Parliament to do that. Because men have been largely erased from so much of the conversational subject, which is centrally about men. And this is why campaigns like Don't Be That Guy campaign are so important, because domestic abuse and violence against women and girls are symptoms of socialisation of boys and the definitions of manhood society creates and upholds that lead to these current outcomes. For so long, women have been the only ones to stand up and speak out against male violence. I know men who care deeply about this issue, but caring deeply is not enough. We need more men to have the courage and the strength to stand up and not remain silent in the face of abuse. We need men to challenge the behaviours and attitudes that, if left alone, manifest and transform into rape and murder of women. We need this so abusive behaviour will be seen as unacceptable, not just because it's illegal, but because it's wrong and unacceptable in peer culture. As Jackson Katz says, we need men to break the silence in male culture about this ongoing tragedy of men's violence against women. And just to conclude again, to thank Kate Clark for bringing forward this motion today. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McLennan. I now call Russell Finlay to be followed by Pauline McNeill.
Thank you. I'm very pleased to speak in this debate brought forward by Katie Clark and agree with her motion and what's already been said by her, and indeed the very important points raised by Paul McLennan about the deep-rooted nature of some of these crimes and the responsibility of men across society to do something about that. I have got faith in the new Lord Advocate, Dorothy Bain QC, who has clearly got her work cut out. Not only has she been left with the mess of the Rangers' malicious prosecutions caused by her male predecessors, but she's got an even bigger issues of the tens of thousands of backlogged criminal cases and how so many women and girls are still failed by the justice system. Now, last month, the Lord Advocate candidly told the Criminal Justice Committee that victims of sexual offences may not be getting justice, and her candour is welcome. Now, while anyone can be a victim of domestic violence, we know that the majority of victims are indeed female. The National Procurator Fiscal for Domestic Abuse, Moira Price, recently said the Crown takes a rigorous approach to these crimes and to the crime of stalking. These include a presumption in favour of prosecution where there is sufficient evidence, better training and prosecutors working more closely with the police. But I still hear far too many accounts of women being failed by the justice system. In recent times, there was the so-called Boys' Club of police officers in Murray. A female police officer reported a catalogue of alleged bullying and criminality, but her concerns were ignored. Then there are victims of stalking who tell me how the criminal justice system exacerbates their ordeal. Manipulative men abuse our courts by using spurious excuses to string out proceedings. This can last for years, even before COVID, and I believe it's a tactic of control, which is in itself an extension of the stalking campaign. Then there's the woman whose serious domestic violence case limped through the courts for 4 long years. At every turn, her attacker played the system and sought delays and excuses not to proceed. In the end, he was even allowed to strike a plea deal to have numerous charges either dropped or watered down quite significantly. Now, this brave woman and many others tell me they would not go through it again. Damningly, they say they would advise others in the same position not to engage with the system, which I would obviously not encourage, but these are people who have been through horrific ordeals. Now, some criminals know that using this tactic of what's known as churn, the constant delaying of cases, can result in witnesses moving on, forgetting key details, and victims simply losing patience. Then there's also the practice of plea deals, which largely operate unseen from the public eye. I was pleased when the Lord Advocate gave a commitment recently in response to a question I asked that these will not, the temptation to use these by prosecutors to clear the backlog will not happen. They will not be misused for that purpose. Now, as already mentioned by Katie Clark, I'm very interested in the new report by the Virtual Trials National Project Board. Now, amongst other things, it calls for specialist online courts to deal with domestic abuse cases. It sounds from what Ms Clark has said that these have been very successful and welcomed positively, not just by victims, but indeed by legal practitioners and others involved in the process. They say that this would increase protection and reduce trauma for victims. It's this kind of radical approach that the Lord Advocate needs to consider. And while she's got victims on her side and many MSPs backing change, one challenge might come from the powerful legal lobby, which often seems culturally resistant to change. I'm sure that we all wish her the best of luck. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Finlay. And I now call Pauline McNeill, who will be the last speaker before I ask the Minister to respond.
Thank you to my colleague, Katy Clark, for bringing this important debate to Parliament. And I commend the excellent speeches of Paul McLennan and Russell Findlay. Domestic violence must remain at the top of the agenda of this Parliament because by its very nature, violence committed usually by men against women is committed behind closed doors. It's on the increase, it's more prevalent during the pandemic, and sadly, these figures are heading in the wrong direction. The men who think they will never be held accountable when they use physical or psychological violence have to fear a robust criminal justice system. And that is why the existence of specialist domestic courts can play a very significant role. Male violence against women is endemic in our societies. We've all debated many times. But we know it's a global issue and it's on the rise globally, sadly. If we have to have any chance of making any serious inroads, as I've said many times, I believe we need to start teaching our boys and girls at a young age what is and what is not acceptable in relationships. As I have had a chance to discuss with the Minister, the cross-cutting programmes that are being conducted and are needed in justice, education and equality are absolutely vital. I know we agree on that point. Talk of rape culture in schools, the sending of unsolicited photographs is becoming commonplace. Every time I open a newspaper, I'm reading more of this. Sexual violence inflicted on teenage girls. It is really alarming, and sadly, it's more alarming now than it probably was a few years ago. So it's something for this Parliament to address. And in a recent Sunday Post report, 3 out of 5 girls said they had endured some form of sexual harassment. We need a seismic shift in attitudes to reverse this trend. We need to focus on what's happening in our schools and in our education system. I fully support the government's Equally Safe programmes that promote healthy relationships, and I also support the work of Rape Crisis Scotland. I do think we need to hear how it can be rolled out across the country. The pandemic has highlighted just how unsafe home is for many women. The United Nations declared a shadow pandemic as women across the world face being stuck with their abuse and unable to get help or respite. Lockdown also cut off access for children to a safe space out of the home. The number of domestic abuse cases reported to police in 2020-21 was over 65,000. These are quite shocking statistics. When we consider that only 1 in 10 cases are estimated to be reported, it gives even more pause for thought. So specialist domestic abuse courts do seem to be an appropriate way to address the magnitude of the problem of domestic violence. If we think there is an appropriate solution, then we need to make sure that they are rolled out. Of course, domestic abuse does not only take the form of violence. Psychological abuse, such as coercive and controlling behaviour, can have a profound and damaging long-lasting effect on any individual. It's a pattern of behaviour that's often not obvious at first, but it can do real damage, and it's been a crime since 2019. We also have to be alert to the fact that perpetrators are now often using social media and software like Apple AirTags to track victims. It was Isabel Unain from Women's Aid who said stalking and tech abuse are very real and dangerous forms of abuse, with survivors who have been sought by their ex-partners often at the greatest risk of harm. Given the scope which domestic abuse can take, we need specialist courts to provide the resources and expertise to deal with this issue. I'm glad to take part in a debate, although I'm obviously sad to reflect on the figures. I know that there is an absolute energy behind this in terms of the government's approach to this, and across party, I don't think it's a party issue. This is sadly an issue for society to deal with. It's not just a problem in Scotland, but in Scotland, I think we are leading the way, and we can continue to lead the way by the adoption, the further adoption of domestic courts to apply our specialist prosecutors and those who work in our courts to make sure that we can provide a solution and make clear that we have a robust system for anyone who wants to abuse, men or women. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McNeill. And I now call on Minister Ash Regan to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I'd like to begin tonight by thanking Katy Clark for lodging the motion for debate today. And also, I commend her clear desire for action on this subject, which I really like to, I like to see that. And I would share it as well. So, domestic abuse has been one of this Parliament's priorities, with a sea change in public attitudes since this Parliament was formed. And in the not-too-distant past, all too often there was a dominant view that domestic abuse was a private matter that took place behind closed doors and it was no business of the criminal law or the justice system. And thankfully, that misjudged view has been well and truly demolished, and there's a broad consensus that domestic abuse is a shared issue and that an effective justice system response is essential in protecting victims. So the vast majority of domestic abuse is committed by men against women, and I think we all recognise now this is not a women's issue, but they are disproportionately affected by it, and that men have to take responsibility. And it's heartening to see that so many men are taking responsibility for their own actions and no longer being bystanders to the actions of others, and that was a point that was well made by Paul McLennan in his contribution. Presiding Officer, the Parliament has taken significant steps to improve the criminal law response to domestic abuse, and in 2010, Parliament acted swiftly to close a loophole in breach of the peace law with the introduction of a new offence of threatening or abusive behaviour. And in 2016, this Parliament introduced a new statutory aggravation of domestic abuse, and in 2018, a new specific offence of domestic abuse was introduced. And this has been lauded by experts who work with victims of domestic abuse as being world-leading or gold standard legislation. And countries all over the world are looking to learn from the Scottish domestic abuse offence. And for the first time under the criminal law, this new offence captures the totality of what is domestic abuse for victims. Conduct that is criminalised includes physical abuse, but also psychological abuse, all too evident in the coercive and controlling behaviours displayed by perpetrators. And the value of having a law that captures this type of insidious behaviour is that victims and those supporting victims can see that the law is on their side. Perpetrators also will understand behaviour amounting to coercive and controlling domestic abuse is not tolerated and can be dealt with under the criminal law. So the motion for debate raises important issues about how the justice system responds to domestic abuse and the role that specialist domestic abuse courts may have. And I would agree with a number of contributors, Katy Clark and Pauline McNeill among them, you know, that they do appear to play a significant role in this. And it's important to briefly remind the Chamber that the operation of the criminal courts is an independent responsibility of the Lord President as head of the Scottish judiciary. And the Parliament has enshrined that independent role in statute through the Judiciary and Courts Scotland Act of 2008. And as such, it is not for this Parliament or the Scottish Government to instruct the judiciary as to how the courts should operate. And where the judiciary themselves consider it appropriate for specialist courts to operate, then it's right for Parliament and Government to consider how best that can be supported. So on the 21st of January, the Virtual Trials National Project Board, chaired by Sheriff Principal Pyle, published a report on the piloting of virtual summary trials, recommending that specialist online courts be set up to tackle domestic abuse cases. And the report highlighted the opportunity to mitigate the impact of the pandemic on court processes for survivors of domestic abuse, as well as reducing trauma. And we will now work with justice agencies to move these recommendations forward. Presiding Officer, a key aspect of specialist domestic abuse courts is that they guide survivors through the process to sentencing with appropriately trained staff available and advocacy support built in. And specialist courts can have a significant role to play in delivering better access to justice.
And that's why there are specialist domestic abuse courts operating in Glasgow and Edinburgh as part of how the judiciary consider it best to deal with such offending in those areas. And the original pilot of specialist domestic abuse courts in Glasgow, that's dating back to the mid-2000s, was positively evaluated and praised by victims' organisations, resulting in its permanent establishment, and then other courts followed. So the motion rightly talks about evaluation of the benefits of specialist courts. I'm aware that Katy Clark wasn't in Parliament when the new offence of domestic abuse was being debated in 2018, when there was discussion about specialist courts at that time. And Parliament agreed that understanding better how different types of courts deal with domestic abuse was an essential element in assessing the role of, that specialist courts could play. And that is one reason why there is a statutory reporting requirement contained in the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act of 2018, which requires the Scottish Government to publish information on the experiences of victims and witnesses in relation to the new offence. And that information will be published in a series of reports we're expecting later on in 2022 and also into next year as well. So, respecting the constitutional position of the Lord President, one of the reports will contain information provided from the Lord President as to how domestic abuse court business has been arranged to deliver that efficient disposal of cases. The impact of the pandemic, I imagine, will permeate through these reports, from which I'm sure there will be further learning. And, Presiding Officer, the motion notes that official figures reflect an increase in domestic abuse reporting, and that was a point that Katy Clark made in her contribution this evening as well. And whilst I think this is a stark reminder of how far we have to go in eradicating domestic abuse, I think it also may indicate that more victims are coming forward as well to report. So recent figures show that 84% of court proceedings involving a charge under the Domestic Abuse Scotland Act are leading to a conviction. I am very encouraged that the law is doing what it was intended to do. So, Presiding Officer, prioritisation of domestic abuse cases was a welcome decision taken by the Lord President early in the pandemic as a recognition of the trauma for such cases and survivors. And the Scottish Government funding of £50 million in this financial year to support the criminal courts system recovery from the pandemic was also an essential part of helping deliver justice, including in domestic abuse cases. So I think this has been a useful debate today with some very important issues that have been aired. And I just want to reaffirm the Scottish Government's commitment to preventing and eradicating violence against women and girls and continue to support the work of justice agencies and the third sector in delivering better outcomes for survivors of domestic abuse.
Thank you, Minister. That concludes the debate, and I close this meeting.